Cool. All right. So cool. Thanks. We're at the panel. We're at the towards the end of the day. Hope you had a really good afternoon tea there. So this panel is more of just a discussion group to discuss a few issues that are cropping up in radio and open source, basically discuss the future of both together. And so we've got these guys out here in the front. We're going to ask some questions to them. I've got some questions here, but basically if you've got a question, just put your hand up and we'll get a microphone out to you. And then basically the idea is that these guys are here to get you guys starting to talk as well. So it's not just this way, it's both ways. Anyway, so we have Justin, who you heard from before the break on the HPSDRs, VK7TW. Stephen, A1 AIQ. I can't even read my writing, does it? I'm one slide behind, sorry. AI4QR. Paul, VK1ATP. Ian, VK7IS. And Ben, VK7BN. But before we actually start asking the serious questions, I thought I would give these guys a bit of an exam from the 1978 novice exam. So they've dropped a few questions since then. But basically, if a valve has seven separately connected pins on its base and two of these pairs are connected to the valve heater, thus the valve is likely to be a diode, a triode, a pentode, or an anode.
What's a valve?
Yes. Yeah.
Obviously, it's a pentode.
Obviously, it's based by a process of elimination. 7 minus 2 is a pentode. But so you can still, if you don't know the answer, you can kind of guess the answer in 1978. That's how.
It's a tube with 5 active elements in it. They are typically triodes. Pentodes are typically used for certain types of operation. A pentode might, because it has multiple grids, be used as both a mixer and an oscillator in a regenerative receiver where you can combine functions in one tube or one valve.
Yeah. Why did that skip? There we are. So I had this problem this morning with my other slides. I pressed the wrong button. So yeah, cool. We just just thought I'd keep these guys on their toes because, you know, a couple of you guys were thinking of going for your license there. These guys have done their license in the past. They're glad that I didn't ask the essay questions. So one of the big things that I've mentioned to this morning with amateur radio and open source that we both do really well is building communities, and I think we do this in different ways. And so I'd like to sort of ask a few questions on how these guys and you guys actually do your amateur radio stuff and how it mixes with your open source projects as well. So I'll just get started with, and the answer will be the same for a few people on the panel here, is that, you know, what is your local club, where is it, and how much goes on there? So this might just be for the visiting members of the panel, and perhaps we can have a quick look around the room to see who might be at a club that's nearby that you have not been to and might want to get visit and start collaborating with people. So,
well, my club is the Canberra Region Amateur Radio Club. We do a whole bunch of things. We have various repeaters set up around the town, one in town, one on mountains outside, both 2 and 70. There's DMR and D-Star and recently DMR repeaters. That's digital modes for those who don't know. We have a reasonable WISN, which I forget what it stands for, but it's... there you go. that something emergency network. So a bunch of volunteers who work with the local community to have communications for events. The main ones we do are the Canberra Rally. There's people out at checkpoints and the start and end of the stages. There's a gigantic horse race that goes around the outback of Canberra, and that we help out there. Every first Wednesday, I think, is Shack Night. Someone else who's in the club might correct me on that, where you can go and get some advice or just have a look at some cool stuff that the guys bring along. And club meetings are every other Wednesday. And that's administration stuff, which I have nothing to do with at the moment.
Next. So I'm here in Hobart. I was previously in ACT, so I was more familiar with that club setup. Tassie, I'm still finding my feet, but the local club is Reist. But I'm probably going to let the other Tassie guys talk about that more. You'll get a better picture, I think.
I'm fortunate in my area. We have a wealth of amateur radio operations and clubs. I'm a member of the Huntsville Amateur Radio Club. I live in just outside of Huntsville, Alabama, in the U.S. That club is very active in community service. We work a century, 100-mile bike ride every year. We work the marathon, and most of those members are also active in the amateur radio emergency services, and we are very closely tied and have a good relationship with our local emergency management agency and have been called in on numerous occasions to help. We also have the North Alabama DX Club, which is a different sort of game. These are people who are more interested in performance and contesting, and both of those clubs have educational presentations at their meetings. And then we have a repeater association that maintains, I don't know, a total of 7 or 8 different repeaters in the area and links with for weather events, which we have fairly often in North Alabama with tornadoes and high wind storms. We can link repeaters over the entire north half of the state and the southern half of Tennessee, and all the way from the western Alabama border up to the middle of Tennessee, distance of, I don't know, 500 miles. So we get extremely good coverage in severe weather events.
I'll let Ben talk about Reist, but I'll talk about, I'm a member of WISON, Tasmania South. We help out with mainly equine endurance events, so horsey events that wander around in the bush. We provide safety checkpoints for them. We also help out with extreme fire events. We are backup operators for the fire service. And also Targa Tasmania, which is the big tarmac rally that goes around Tasmania. We supply personnel for that as well. So that's WISON.
Okay. As Justin said, and we've got Ian there as well, we have the Radio and Electronics Association of Southern Tasmania down here in the south. There's also NTARC, the Northern Tasmania Amateur Radio Club in the north as well, if you're in the Launceston area. We typically hold regular presentations once a month, usually the first Wednesday of the month. At the moment, our other Wednesday evenings were the ATV Experimenters Night. They, for the moment, have turned into the Satellite Experimenters Night. And we're sort of out there trying to build a bit of community up right now using special interest groups. So we've got the Satellite Experimenters. We've got Scott running the SDR Special Interest Group. There's a 23-centimetre special interest group which holds QSO parties every Sunday morning to see who's out there on 23 centimetres. We started publishing newsletters this year after a bit of a hiatus. Facebook pages to get the information out. One of the things, funny enough, ham radio operators are really good at communicating to themselves, but not out to the public, certainly down around these parts anyway. And so right now we're just starting the process of getting a more public image. We had participated in the Festival of Bright Ideas last year, which got us in front of about 3,000 school kids, plus I think there was about 15,000 members of the public who came through during the two-day event down on the docks at Salamanca down here. And we had a variety of things. You've actually seen a couple of those things we had there behind us with the, which I talked about in my talk earlier. So, yeah, we're working on the community building. And so I might ask everyone who's here, is there anyone here in a radio club that isn't local? Yeah. No.
No. Okay. So you're from VK1. Oh, okay. Cool. any other... So I kind of feel myself as the amateur radio club have got a sort of a history of being roughly analogous to the Linux user groups, which have seen some decline over the last few years due to the internet and more things being project-based than just, you know, install fests and things like that. But and the fact that nowadays, you know, many kits and kit building or things are can be a bit of a solo affair. But I'm just wondering what in our local clubs we can do to sort of make projects that are essentially licensed open source that have multiple contributors and have a little bit more of a run than just a small experiment.
So before I address that, you mentioned Linux communities and user groups. There are also resources available. There's a Linux Hams group. There's Linux in the Ham Shack podcast. There's an Ubuntu Hams group that you can find online. There was a, I think there's still an active Red Hat Hams group, and you can find those. They're generally active through Wiki and chat. And if you have any questions about open source tools for various ham radio things, that's generally the place to go. Or issues, it's a really good place to get support. As far as outreach, the place that I see most new hams coming from in the United States is from hackerspaces, makerspaces, maker fairs, and conferences like DEF CON. The security people who are interested in hacking things and knowing how things work. DEF CON generated more new ham licenses in their testing session this last year than any testing session I'm aware of in history. Hundreds of people took and passed their exams at the DEF CON Security Hacker Conference in Las Vegas. And they're running wireless villages at these various conferences that are outside of the normal ham circles and outside of the normal Linux conference circles, and it's a really, really good place to bring new people in, and there's a lot of overlap with open source.
So maybe looking at building communities within amateur radio, I guess that can be a bit interesting because often there are the smaller projects like Scott mentioned where it's like build a, you know, swim gym or something that's a very short-lived project, sort of one night. But to get people to occur again, some of the things that have sparked interest locally lately, at least for myself as being sort of someone new in, you know, a local community is, say, the SDR stuff, where their projects possibly about building up more of a system and the tools to be able to look at longer term projects and then work together and getting people up to the clubs. But I think it's those long lived projects which can be harder to come by. So.
And I suppose an example locally, we've had a few projects within the club. You mentioned the Slim Jim. We had a 2 and 70 centimetre antenna building exercise. But one that probably was a little bit longer than that and sparked a bit more interest and a bit broader interest was we had a linked dipole workshop specifically to do with the introduction of the VK7 SOTA Association. So when it went live, we had a workshop where people could come along. They could design how many frequencies they wanted to cover with their link dipole, and then we built them, tuned them, and they then went away and hopefully started activating SOTA. So that it provided just that little bit, that sort of impetus to do it, and get active on SOTA. I'm a SOTA devotee. In fact, I'm going to spend the next 3 days up on summits in Mount Field. So, so yeah, it provided just that little bit more interest. So, yeah.
Yeah, I think everyone sort of touched on an important point here, that a lot of the successes come with finding that groups of people doing something. Certainly, the Radio and Electronics Association is one big club. But if you actually take a closer look, there's whole groups of people within that who have their own interests in a particular subject, be it SOTA, portable operations, 23 centimetres, satellites. There's people there who are actually interested in the packet communications as well. And so you actually form those groups within the organisation. I think that can also be said a lot about some open source program, open source projects, where you've got the one larger overarching project, and then within that there are particular parts where a group of people will just work on a particular component. So I don't know how many people, there are many people involved with open source projects here. So if I come over, could you tell me a little bit about them? No? Hang on, cool. That's okay, it doesn't have to be about radio.
Cool,
I'll go here first.
If you guys are, anyone's working on any radio-based open source project, grab the mic and let us know about it.
I'm Matt, VK2LK, and the project I've been working on since 2008 is a open source P25 transmitter and receiver stack. The project is called OP25, and it was presented at RuxCon in 2010 and 2011. We've got about probably 5 to 6 core developers that have written the DSP code, the modeling of the filters, and then people like myself who've researched the specifications and looked for security flaws, and we found unauthenticated denial of service inhibitor attacks, because command packets that are used to disable stolen radios, there's no cryptographic challenge or anything. You just craft a packet with the destination address and the radio is disabled. So we notified the authorities and Motorola and whatnot, and they sort of took heed. We also found a known plain text attack in the voice stream. The first 365 bits of the voice stream were always set to the same values. So when you encrypt your communications using a weak algorithm such as RC4 or DES, you could very easily brute force because you had a known plaintext ciphertext pair. Part of it was we had to avoid patent infringement issues because the voice codec is called IMBE, which is patented by a company called DBSI. And the patent specification, we reverse engineered parts of that and we made it all open source. And since open source code itself, it's just a description. It's not until you compile that code and you have an object code or executable code and charge money for that, then you're up for patent violations. So we released it all as open source and didn't have any problems. But yeah, I think it was a massive project. It was very heady and took some really smart people to pull it off. But yeah, we did it. So
cool.
It can be done, but as we're talking about, the hardest part was finding the right people, and that was the key to it.
How did you find the right people?
Because my background was more from the radio side as opposed to the open source side, I bridged the gap between, and this was 2008. This was long before RTL SDR, or it was way back before it was common. I could, communicate between the software guys who were really good with GNU Radio and C++ and Python and, those libraries and those sides of things, and I could explain to them how digital radios worked in practice. Yeah, so I guess that's how I did it back then. It was, but now it's not really relevant to the situation today, but I just felt like telling my story, so.
Yeah. Thank you for that.
Cool. Anyone else doing some sort of open source project they want to show? Tell us how to actually get members interested in the project and basically a recruiting tool.
Well, I actually wanted to ask you guys a question about a generational problem. I've noticed you mentioned that Linux user groups are, you know, receding a bit. There's still plenty of activity on places like GitHub,
yep.
But you'll notice this is a Linux event. That mm-hmm. means that the average age of the people in the room is pushing 50, and there's one woman, and I had to search for her. we're really insular.
Yes.
And yep. That's a problem. But the radio pro thing I'm doing right now is we did a software-defined processor. I'm giving a talk on some of it on Thursday, but we basically, when the patents on Super H expired, we reverse-engineered it, did a clean room clone, released it BSD-licensed VHDL, and we crammed it down so it will actually fit in a $50 FPGA board and boot Linux to a shell prompt. And we got like 40% of that free to add other stuff. And one of the things we're adding is GPS correlators. And I am doing a GPS implementation that we get raw signal data in through a like 35-cent chip or something like that. And we take the data, we run it through the correlators, we do the satellite acquisition to find where the satellites are, doing the brute force search on the assumption that we don't have enough power to do the Fourier transform one, although we've got a DSP-based solution also doing the Fourier transform. There's people doing stuff in parallel. And the problem is this is brain-melting stuff that I've gotten most of the pieces of it working, although there's some parts. Our end goal, the reason we're not using a packaged solution in addition to not wanting an extra chip that we have to license, is that what we're trying to do is we're trying to get nanosecond accurate timestamps on all of our boards so that the sensor inputs that we're getting can be timestamped so that we're making something called synchrophasers mm-hmm. that, you know, the electrical grid is designed on the idea that all the power is generated in the center and it goes out in one direction. And if you start feeding solar and wind and stuff back in from the edges, people's light bulbs explode and it falls over and bad things happen because the grid is blind. Mm. So we're retrofitting it with sensors that talk to the cell network and talk to GPS and all this thing. And then they can timestamp, I saw this measurement here, because if there's like a microsecond dropout that, I saw this microsecond dropout here and I saw it there. That means electricity is arcing between two of the high voltage lines for just an instant because the insulation is breaking down and it's doing it here. And I can use signal propagation through the cable to say where the backhoe should point. All mm-hmm. these fun things like that, but we've got to make the GPS stuff work.
Yep.
And making the GPS stuff work is completely tangential to what we're trying to do. If there was the closest package we found of somebody else doing it is a guy called Andrew Holm, that his stuff is based on this weird stack processor that goes in an FPGA. His hardware setup doesn't really go with our stuff at all. And the other thing is he licensed it under GPL, meaning none of the power companies that we're partnering with would ever deploy it. They don't want to get that on them. Mm-hmm. So it's like we're kind of trying to build a community for something that I had to have somebody who's much better at math than I am walk me through these things, and then I write very, very simple explanations and try not to scare away people who go, you do realize there's a 900-page book on this. And I go, yes, I tried to read the 900-page book. About a third of it, as far as I can tell, is just filler from somebody who's trying to look smart, and you can't implement GPS from this book because there's bits missing. It's really frustrating. I would love to tap into the existing community of people who already know how to do this. This is something that's hugely useful, and I can't find one.
Yeah.
There should be one. I have to flip and make one so that I'm not stuck doing this 15 years from now.
Yeah.
I want to move on.
I just, as a personal comment, when I got involved with the Satnogs project a few months ago, the way that I got into it was actually doing the mundane work of writing tests for stuff that, you know, the core devs want to do, but they don't have the time to do it. And I thought to understand the code was actually just to write tests for it until I got my tests working. And then they've got, you know, 75-80% test coverage, and they're really happy. But at the same time, they've got another developer. That kind of low-hanging fruit frees up.
When I do tests, I break stuff. I break so much stuff just from not even formalized testing, just trying it out.
Yeah.
It's like, this happened. It shouldn't have happened. Here's how to reproduce it.
Yeah. I'm not saying that tests are the way to go, but I'm just saying it's like the way there was low-hanging fruit there to be able to bring some people into the community to do some productive work and at the same time free up resources for... and time for the core devs.
Yeah, but where do you find the people?
That's, you know, I stumbled across it myself. That's the hard pressure. But, like, you know, if you've got the fruit there and showing it on GitHub, you know.
Hang on.
Yeah.
One thing I found on the OP25 project was if the idea was good enough and the web page and your wiki and everything marketed in the right way, the good people would actually come to you. The idea, when we planted the seed of a software-defined radio transmitter receiver, so many people were interested and saw the possibilities of opening up this world where we could experiment and explore that. I would Google for my own project, our own project, sorry, it wasn't mine, but I'd Google for OP25 and I'd find in forums, radio reference, communication support, people in those fields were downloading it and talking about it and discussing it, but not getting in touch with me or the project, and then I'd reach out. So,
one of my main hobby projects is Toybox. I wrote the current Android command line because I'm trying to hijack Android and turn it into a self-hosting development environment so that you can build Android under Android and don't need a PC anymore. there's all sorts of people, and they never. CyanogenMod has like 30 patches for Toybox that. When I found out about this, it's like, okay, you've been patching it for a year and change, and you never bothered to tell me. Thank you very much. You know, that's... Yeah, well, the thing you were talking about is, you know, you have a good web page, you go out and do the work. I've found that you will actually start to get traction at the 2 to 3 year mark. Is where people will go, oh, I guess this isn't going away. Maybe it's actually, you know, something interesting. That's where it starts to kind of trickle in and ramp up. But you've got to persist a long time in the wilderness to do something unless you're leveraging some existing project the way, you know, Linux leveraged Minix. There was an existing comp.os.minix community that was frustrated that their patches couldn't go into Minix because Tannenbaum didn't take external contributions. And Linus, you know, went, oh, I take patches, and they ported all their patches to his thing, and this multi-year backlog of work people had already done just, you know, slammed into the thing, and suddenly it went to 0.95 in a month.
I'm struck that this is an interesting thread,
that
we have
a panel
and radio.
There we do.
Yeah.
Well, it's good to see that that there are still the same issues we're having in amateur radio clubs as well as open source projects, which is not a solved problem there. Yep.
There are separate communities in, like, universities and stuff of younger people. Have you managed to do any kind of successful outreach? You mentioned Maker
Faire. Yep. I've done a lot of successful outreach myself to young, unfortunately only young men, through the scouting organization, setting up for a jamboree on the air and doing that sort of thing. I also taught a number of classes at a local hacker makerspace. I think
The most fruitful place to recruit right now is the technical conferences that are not necessarily open source conferences. DEF CON, SHMU CON, B-Sides, any place that has a wireless village. You can search on the internet for wireless village and you'll find conferences where they are. There are people who are actively engaged. There are amateurs who are running testing sessions and things like that, but they are all mostly of a different generation, and they're not. And when I talk to younger people, I have to tell them, you know, you go to a club. There are all sorts of different clubs. A lot of clubs are very monolithic demographically. A lot of them are only the guys that have known each other for, and they're guys. I say guys because it is guys, and they've known each other for 30 years, and they meet every Friday night, and they talk about stuff, and that's all they do. If that's not your thing, check out another club. Go to the makerspace. You have to, you can't make the mistake of thinking that the entire hobby or avocation is represented by the first group that you have contact with, because it may not be representative. The other thing that I think is really important is to drag ham people into the open source world. And by showing things like HBSDR, and we did a kit build at our local club of the one of the smart rock receivers. And for, you know, for $20, you put this thing together. If you've never really experienced SDR, you put this thing together and you hook it up to a sound card and wow, it's amazing. You know, it's an amazing introduction to software-defined radio. So pulling people the other way into our open source community is also very valuable.
Cool.
Just one thought on, and sort of bring that sort of full circle, the idea of how do you get sort of new people into the community, seeing it from sort of both sides. I did a little bit of contribution similar to what Scott said with an open source project, which was the Gossip Protocol, which was originally on Google Code, then went to GitHub, and then finally just recently went to an Apache incubator project as it sort of worked its way up. But that had gone through years, but it was that case of sort of build it and they will come. And I've seen similar things in amateur radio, especially back in, say, Canberra and ACT. There I did a 2-meter weekly net. Because initially I was like, how come there's no sort of VHF, UHF comms? And it was like, well, no one's really doing it, but in Canberra it does kind of work. It's a bit hilly, not like here, but so in theory it should work. So I set that up, and initially had about 5 people, got up to 20s, once I think got about 30 people. And you got that happening. But one other interesting thing that then spawns out of that, so that's still that insular group you mentioned, because you're saying, you know, other operators come and do this. But from being in my vehicle on top of a hill, sometimes with just the antenna on the car, but other times going out, say, on field days and putting up a 10-element 2-meter Yagi, like, people see that, obviously, and they come over and say, wow, what's that? And you get young people coming along going, wow, what's that about? And then you can spark that interest, but that's still building it, and they will come. So you just sometimes got to wait a little bit, I think.
Yeah, I was just going to say, I totally agree with the going out and doing things. The number of times I've actually set up for a parks activation, which is a bit like the Summits on the Air, the soldier stuff, except it's in a national park. I've set up my great big dipole antenna to work HF off my car. It's big aluminium mast. There's radio in the car. There's computers sitting in the bag. And a number of bushwalkers who come up to me looking rather bewildered and go, what's that? And then having to talk them through it, and they get all interested and ask for more information. Invariably, yeah, I send them off to a website and stuff. So, yeah, it certainly is that aspect is there.
Yeah, one more comment is that I've met many, many, many young people, especially younger people, who are, they're playing with the Blade RF, the Hack RF, the RTL SDR. They're receiving airplane positions. They're hacking key fobs for automobiles. They're playing with all sorts of RF, but they're not licensed amateurs, and they're not transmitting by and large, or if they are, it's low power stuff, but they've discovered sort of this magic of radio, but they've never really had an intersection with the amateur radio community that's made them want to join, and so those people are ripe for the picking on the amateur side, and that's one of the things that conferences like DEF CON are doing, is providing the licensing exam structure.
One of the things that I noticed with my projects is, not my radio projects, but, you know, for example, if there's a lot of younger people on GitHub, I would put my project on GitHub, not because I needed any of that infrastructure, and I find it really annoying when I get like bug reports or pull requests through I gotta go to a web interface, blah, blah, blah. But that's where, you know, I have to go where they are to what they're comfortable with. And it's not so much exposure to my project, it's retention. I have a lot of people who just sort of wander through, and then after a week I never see them again. Unless, you know, it's something they can subscribe to through a thing they're already familiar with, and they keep tabs on it that way.
Okay, yeah, we're a little far afield from amateur radio, but I have a number of projects that I maintain, and I adore drive-by patches. Well, a single patch from somebody I never see again makes my day.
Cool. We actually covered a whole bunch of questions there just by, you know, which I had written down, so that's really good. I just thought I might sort of pivot now quickly to sort of some issues about spectrum and regulation. I'm not exactly sure of the answer to this myself, but recently the WIA made submission to ACMO about basically trying to expand the foundation license to give them access to some more power, and also some digital modes and computer control. That process is now with ACMA. Is there any? When do we expect some kind of traction? Some outcome of that, maybe. How fast does the cogs of government work?
Watch this space.
Oh, okay.
Getting very little from ACMA Rod at the moment. They are just coming out of the Christmas hibernation, so watch this space.
Okay, yep. I've ordered a bunch of the LoRa, low-range radio kits, run at, you know, 915 megahertz on the ISM band, but they actually use AES encryption, and, you know, amateur radio by its regulations usually doesn't allow encryption. But how there is one or two instances where it can be used, but what else can we actually use with amateur radio to essentially make our communications secure if we can't use the encryption component of it? So
you can't.
Yeah. Ah. However, can you
encode information using defined encodings that can be decoded by anybody, but you can't actually encrypt your communications. Now, this is an interesting aspect of the satellite project that I'm on, because we're going to have to authenticate users, and so it's going to have to be, you can do authentication with open keys if the private keys are held in on the back end, and we have a design discussion. We're in the early phases, but it's an interesting problem to solve within the open framework.
Okay.
It's a satellite. They are directional antennas.
I was just wondering, we can essentially use some message signing, but that's about it, really. Can't we?
The U.S. government has been pretty clear that you can't encrypt anything.
I had a friend of mine in Canada.
Yeah.
Wasn't that run AS 256 on B25? Sorry. Yeah,
an amateur radio friend in Canada did manage to convince Industry Canada to let him run AES encryption on his P25 repeater for voice communications. And the specific wording in the International Amateur Radio Union's law that then filters down to the local law like ACMA or FCC regulations was worded that you're not allowed to intentionally obfuscate the meaning of a message. So he convinced Industry Canada, he said, well, if I publish the key on the internet, anyone can listen in if they want to. And they said, okay, sure, but you know, it's not likely that someone's going to go out and buy an AS module and a P25 radio and then put the key in just to listen to some boring ham talk. So he said that by making the keys public, he wasn't intentionally trying to hide any information and there was therefore still an open system. And that worked, kind of, but it wasn't obviously secure by definition for a, you know, to an IT person. So
cool.
Just sort of throw it out there.
Mm. All right. We're sort of running out of time again, so I'm actually just going to probably flip towards the end because we've only got a couple of minutes left and actually draw some prizes here because so we have to get Rex up on the stage shortly for his next talk. But who wants to do the... All right. Do we have Greg Dark here? Oh, cool. Woohoo. Do you want both? Awesome. Awesome. Thank you. Hope you do well with that down there. All right. Cool. We got here, Lawrence Muir. See you? Nope. All right.
Must be present to win.
Must be present to win. Cool. Steve T. Awesome. Cool. DK7. Which one do you like? This one? And this one? You want the hat? That plus that? Or?
Okay, thank you.
Yep.
Thank you very much.
Cool. And we have one more RTL SDR. To... Oh, there we go. It's curious. Nigel. Zynet, is that right? I think it's Nigel, maybe upside down. No. All right. No, one more. Peter Birch. Nope. All right. I'm going to run out of tickets soon. Michael Still.
Yeah. I've already got three of them.
Knew that would happen. Jordy Miller. Oh. Keep going.
This is what happens when you only turn up to one session.
The odds are getting very good for the people who are left.
Yeah. Ben Martin. Woohoo. All right. Cool. You didn't have to get out of bed early for this one at all. Cool. Well, thanks very much for joining us here today, talking about stuff. Been a bit enlightening going forward, some of the things that we might do next year. We'll put some of these projects on the wiki on the Linux webpage as well. Cool. So we'll be back in about 5-10 minutes for...